Good morning. As we begin our Holy Week, we come to the conclusion of our walk to Jerusalem by extinguishing our last candle. And next Sunday is coming. As the people spread their coats and palm branches on the ground to welcome Jesus into Jerusalem, so we welcome him into our lives this morning. King of glory, Prince of peace, reign in our hearts and lives this day and all days, that we might praise your holy name. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And to all the adults, I invite you to stay seated but wave your palms. We don't want you to miss this wonderful parade of kids. Now we'll tune our attention to the screen where we'll see the words to Hosanna filled with excitement. Here we go. Spread cloaks and branches on the city streets. There in the distance they began to see. There on the journey comes the Savior Christ. From every corner there's a voice is ringing. Praise to the one who comes in the name of God. Our acclamation brings forth shouts of praise. Can we start it over again? Thank you. These guys have worked really hard, and we want you to join along, but we all want to be on the same page. Sarah, is it okay? We're going to start again, everybody. Here we, oh, is it now?
No.
Not yet. Can you give us a cue?
One,
two, three, here we go. No.
Filled with excitement, all the happy throng spread cloaks and branches on the city streets. There in the distance they began to see. There on the lonely comes the Savior Christ. On every corner a thousand voices sing. Praise to the one who comes in the name of God. Our acclamation turns with wonder shouts of praise.
Let's hear you sing this now. Come on. Here we go. One more thing. Let's see, one more. All right, now we go.
As in the entrance to Jerusalem, holds on his evil sin to Jesus Christ, to our Redeemer who took the cross today, ask us to follow with our love and faith. From every corner a thousand voices sing, praise to the one who comes in the name of God. Our acclamations before the shouts of praise, from the song
of my now, everybody, nice and our scripture for today, found on the back of your bulletin, is from Psalm 56, verse 3, and Ariana Ix will read this to us at this time.
When I'm afraid, I put my trust in you.
Thank you so much. Good job. Okay, if you're able, please stand and join me in the call to worship. Open the gates. Open the gates. Open the gates. Open the gates. Open the gates.
Love has come.
Please remain standing and join us in the hymn, The King of Glory Comes. And you can wave your palm fronds if you didn't get enough of a chance to do that.
Thank you. And if you'll remain standing and join me in the unison prayer. Loving God, there are so many choices before us every day. Choices offered by our friends, our families, our culture, our own past. May we learn from the choices of Jesus and embody compassion, justice, and inclusion in all we say and do. Amen. Okay. Please be seated. I have a number of announcements. If you have donations for the Agape Easter food distribution and or cleaning supplies, please leave them in the basket in the Olivet room. There are flyers up about the Women's Yoga Night on May 4th. If you would like to sign up, the sign-up sheet should be on the sanctuary bulletin board, but I didn't see it this morning. Maybe we can write it just right on the flyer if you're interested in participating. Please consider being a liturgist. The sign-up sheet is also on the bulletin board by the soundboard, or you can call the church office and Carolyn can sign you. On April 21st at 1 o'clock, there will be a heal and grief support meeting in the old library. We are having Monday, Thursday services and Good Friday services this week at 7 o'clock, respectively. The Heartland Conference is collecting donations to go to Ukraine. Please call the office or mark your donation accordingly and place it in the basket. I've been asked to report that the band is leaving today to go to Florida. Please keep them in your prayers. And also, I happen to know that a set of conjoined twins are at Dayton Children's Hospital. They were separated on Friday. They have been in the hospital there since, I think, last August. They're almost 4 years old, and they were joined at the head. They are now separated. They can use your prayers. Do we have any other announcements?
Yes, so we missed Maddie directing our music, so she's heading off with the band today. And Nick, her whole family, she needs prayers for her whole family too, she said, by the way. So Nick is along with them, and he has asked, I don't know the details, but the high school is going to do the breakfast next Sunday, so they could use some baked goods. I assume if you can drop them off down in the kitchen area, maybe Saturday-ish or before, that would be good. Another announcement I have, we have a date set for 2023, so not this June, but next June, we're going to take a group of youth down to Back Bay. So we're going to get more information out directly, but it will be current college age and current high school age is kind of the age group we're looking. So we'll get more information out on that. It's set for June 10th through the 17th of 2023. So everybody that has that age group, you can see me for more details now. Obviously we're just starting to plan, but we have the date set and that's what we're looking to do next summer.
Just want to let everybody know that this afternoon, today at 2 o'clock, there's going to be several members of our junior high youth group are in the junior high play. It's the Trial of the Wicked Witch of the West. So it's a great play. It's, I think, $5 to get in, about an hour long. It's a great way to just have a little time in your afternoon on a night, great inside thing. It's a lot of fun. So if you get a chance, it's at the high school in the auditorium. If you get a chance, there's, I think Maddie and Ryan are both, I'm sorry if I'm missing anybody else that is in the youth group that are part of the cast. So
what time?
It starts at 2 o'clock, 2 p.m. Yep. All right, thanks.
Good morning. Pastor Rhonda, could you please step up here? Yeah, uh-oh. As you know, several members of our church went to Back Bay Mission. We each received an envelope from Pastor Rhonda, which then contained 7 more envelopes. Each day, we were to open one and read the message, whether an inspirational message, a prayer, or kind words from Pastor Rhonda. I think we all looked forward to reading these. Now, I have that we had 16 that went from our church, so you do the math with everything that was written. We'd like to thank Pastor Rhonda for her words and prayers, so on behalf of Back Bay Mission attendees, here is your envelope. Please read for your enjoyment.
Thank you, all you Back Bay folks.
Appreciate it.
Any joys and concerns? Guest to introduce? Okay, April anniversaries, please stand. If you stand, if able, and join me in passing of the peace. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I love those photos, but I wasn't sure what those were. Is that junior high?
Yeah, those different films were
that.
Yeah, junior high.
Junior high, okay, all right. The eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Even we shall believe, even we shall be led back to faith by the grace and mercy of the one who never stops seeking after his beloved creation. We are loved, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now, if you are able, please stand and sing All Glory, Laud, and Honor. And if you want to keep waving your little branch, that's okay too. Just don't poke somebody's eye out. may be seated.
Yes, before we begin our prayer, pastoral prayer this morning, I want to reiterate what Jill said. You know, oftentimes we make the assumption that everyone has access to social media, Facebook, TikTok, other avenues of announcements. I was making that assumption as well on behalf of the Heartland Conference. They have been constantly lifting up before us the donations that they are receiving for the Ukraine. We haven't had that printed in our bulletin or newsletter, and I do apologize. And also apologize that I assume everyone has Facebook. So please contact the church office, Carolyn, if you'd like to make a donation. We'll work harder at making sure, because it certainly is on our hearts. Let us begin our prayer. O Lord our God, you enter Jerusalem with peace in your heart. We come this morning seeking your peace in our hearts. The week behind us is over, and we have barely caught our breath, only to begin a new week. Fill us with your strength. Remind us that we are in partnership with you. We do not have to face life alone. We can only do all that is before us through Christ's power and love, and who strengthens us. Our hearts and minds are filled with the relentless and overwhelming needs of our world, broken by division and suspicion, by hatred and war. Hear our prayers as they feel like the only tangible thing we can do. We cry out in prayer on behalf of the people who are your children of Ukraine and other places around the world. Hear our prayers. And may we hold your vision of justice and peace ever before us. This morning we bring you the needs of our community and congregation, the hungry and homeless, the wounded and despairing, the grieving, those who feel no purpose, those who are caregivers for loved ones with no break in sight. So many needs, God, of ourselves and our loved ones, all seeking your peace, your comfort, your will and healing, your wisdom and protection. Hear our prayers, God. Even Jesus took the time to pray and to be silent. Remind us of that through our prayers, meditation, and reflection, we may draw closer to you and find our way on this journey of faith. Spirit of love and life, stay close. These and all the prayers of our hearts we offer in faith as we pray the way you taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our offering is an act of worship and thanksgiving for all God has first given to us. Our gifts support the mission of the church here and around the world to nurture with love and serve with hope. Our offering will be received at this time. Thank you. Thank you. We give in grateful thanksgiving for all that God has given us. In the upside-down world of the gospel, we measure our wealth not by what we have, but what we can give away. Let us give away generously in this offering to bless your church, your people, your creation, O God. Amen. You may be seated.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2, and again 19 through 29. A song of victory. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
Thank you, Jill. Our second scripture lesson comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, verses 28 through 40. This is Luke's account of Jesus' procession into Jerusalem.
After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethphage and Bethany, at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.'" Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out."
This is the word of our living God. Thanks be to God. Have you ever been disappointed? Hope that something would turn out one way and it turned out another. Expected that something was going to be okay, but then it turned out it wasn't going to be okay. Do you know the feeling of disappointment, the sense of struggle and longing that comes with it? I bet you do. As we enter into Holy Week, I think it's important for us to to slow down, pause, and reflect on what is happening on this very day, Palm Sunday. This is the beginning of Holy Week. Later, in this week, we'll laugh and love on Maundy Thursday, and we will weep on Good Friday. But first, we watch as Jesus comes riding in on a colt. Now, I don't know about you, but I've wanted things from Jesus before. I have wanted the pain to dissipate or be removed. I've wanted just a bit longer with someone on this earth. I have wanted better news from test results. I have wanted an end to the suffering of this world's children. Perhaps you have wanted something from Jesus too. Wanted to know that Jesus is real, to be assured of Jesus' presence and Jesus' love. Perhaps you wanted Jesus to fix the problems of life, or you wanted Jesus to quickly change the way things are in the world. Or maybe you've wanted something else. I would say this is quite an average list, quite a list that most people have running through their head. So I wonder, have you ever been disappointed in Jesus? Disappointed when Jesus didn't offer these things you wanted? Disappointed in the way Jesus showed up? Disappointed in what Jesus did or did not do. I imagine the crowd that gathered that day waiting for Jesus were a little disappointed with Jesus that day too. Across town, there's another parade with another person riding in, another crowd, another look, another feel. This historical event is often overlooked, but it sets Jesus' entry into Jerusalem in context. This is the parade of Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, also coming into Jerusalem to assert his strength and dominion over the people, to remind them of his power. Now, if we're being honest, it may be that this parade of pomp and circumstance feels more like what we want and what we think we need, a heroic and physically strong parade, one that can in an instant make a community change its loyalty, one that can in an instant take life away, one that can in an instant give lavish gifts of gold and great wealth, one that can prove its power. A savior who comes to save, who rescues us from any and all danger, a savior who is strong and powerful, a savior who can protect us. And I wonder if sometimes we want our Savior to come in the lavish Roman processional, the processional with pomp and brute strength, the processional that is more organized and better manicured, the processional that displays strength, not confusion and even weakness. Let's be honest with ourselves. Which Savior do we want? The one who holds all the political power? or the one who challenges that political power. On Palm Sunday, we are often encouraged to think of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem as triumphant, a proud display of his strength as he paraded himself toward the cross. Well, Jesus does parade himself into Jerusalem, but I disagree with the narrative that Jesus moves proudly and triumphantly. I think he humbly stumbles into Jerusalem toward the cross. I mean, folks, look at the scene. Instead of a strong horse, Jesus rides in on a colt that has never been ridden before. Never been ridden. Have you ever seen a dog on a leash for the first time or a horse in the midst of rider training? It's a disaster. They zig and zag across the path. They jerk around. They fall. So here comes Jesus riding into Jerusalem on a tiny little colt. A colt who doesn't know how to be ridden. And then to make the scene even more comical, instead of throwing gifts of praise, the people start covering the streets with their cloaks, riding in on a colt to a street lined with haphazardly thrown cloaks. I cannot imagine. It looked very impressive. This whole scene is messy. Literally, Jesus literally comes stumbling into Jerusalem. Jesus' satirical entry into Jerusalem is quite the contrast to the spectacular entry of Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor. I point this out not to make us wonder why Jesus is so weak or vulnerable, or wonder why we worship Jesus on this day when this parade is sort of comical, but rather to point out this is actually the good news. That Jesus comes stumbling into Jerusalem and onto the cross rather than riding pridefully in tells us a lot about who Jesus is. Jesus is not like the one claiming power across town, one who will assert power rather than earn it, one that will control us rather than grant us freedom. In contrast to pompous Pilate, Jesus deliberately comes stumbling into Jerusalem. The Scottish New Testament scholar William Barclay once observed that there are two kinds of courage. There's the kind of courage that prompts someone to throw him or herself in the way of an oncoming car to push a child to safety. It is the kind of bravery that is instinctual, habitual, and is revealed in the moment of crisis. And there's also the kind of courage that sees danger coming a long way off, that has plenty of time to choose an alternative path, and yet chooses to stay the course, to remain faithful, to endure the mounting fear in order to do one's duty. This is the courage Jesus reveals in this scripture. The courage to go stumbling into Jerusalem and eventually to the cross. The courage to reject and not embrace the political power of his day. The courage not to avoid the threat of retribution and rejection, but to face it. the courage to ride into the fate of betrayal and death for the sake of truth and justice. It's not the kind of courage we're used to, and perhaps, again, not the courage we wish for. But this is the courage we need. The courage to be in solidarity with others' pain. The courage to stand up to oppressors and oppression. The courage to die for the love of God and one another. This is the kind of courage we need. And my friends, the good news is that this is the Jesus we have. Earlier this week, I was chatting with some of our faithful and caring members, and one comment struck me as we talked. Someone said, "We are all just stumbling." Indeed, our attempts at faithfulness are sometimes misguided. Our efforts to help and serve are sometimes way off the mark. Our praises can quickly become betrayal. We all don't know what we are doing. There's no roadmap. There's no roadmap to Christian discipleship. And sometimes we even find ourselves at the wrong parade. Indeed, at times we are stumbling on our way to the parade in Jerusalem, unsure of the steps we are taking, hoping that we are moving toward Jesus and not away from him. We come to the parade not perfect, but haggard and in need. We come to the parade having tried what we thought would work, but not completely sure if we took the right path. We all stumble to the parade in desperate need of someone to come and save us. My friends, the Savior we need marches on with courage, even in the midst of seeming weakness. The Savior we need stumbles along with us. The Savior we need accepts us even in our betrayal. The Savior we need has the courage to challenge the political and religious powers that be. The Savior we need rides a colt, not a chariot. This Savior is willing to die for his belief in us. Jesus is the Savior we need. Welcome this Palm Sunday to this parade, his parade, into Jerusalem.
Thank you.
just as God's word was sent into the world to heal and redeem, so God sends you into the world this day to be light and love, healing and hope. Go now to be the light for the world. And may the grace and peace of God, the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer come upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen.